Well, good morning and welcome to all to our online service today. Thank you for tuning in, and I pray that it will be a blessing to all who listen. Now, due to some constraints, we will only be more than likely just putting up this one service online today. And I want to thank all who have helped and encouraged and prayed to get this service on the go this morning. It's been a bit of a challenge, and I thank you for your encouragement and help to get all things working. Now let's just open our time and worship together with wonderful, merciful Saviour. To this time to reflect on what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us. We read very familiar words in 1 John 29. John the Baptist speaking says, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." And I'd like to suggest that there is something in this verse to perceive. This word "behold" is a word that suggests more than a mere glimpse, but it is a word where we are called to examine, and we are called to fix our gaze upon something, something that is worthy of our attention. So that's what we seek to do this morning as we reflect upon the Lord Jesus. We want to behold the Lamb. But not only do we see something to perceive here, but we also see something that has been provided. This is the Lamb of God. And we think back to the many lambs that were sacrificed in the Old Testament for coverings for sin, but none of them were provided by God. And this one was none other than the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. This was the Lamb that God had provided for the world to bear away sin, was none other than his dear Son, the Lord Jesus. So we see something to perceive here. We see something that has been provided, and we also see something that is pure. A lamb speaks of innocence and purity, and in relation to Jesus, it speaks to me and it speaks to us of that sinless life that he led, that he was that one who did no sin and knew no sin in order that he might become that sin offering for us. So something to perceive here, something provided, something pure, but also something very particular here. This is the Lamb. Now, there was only ever one Lamb like this one. This Lamb was the fulfillment of the promise that was made to Abraham many years ago, that God would provide himself a Lamb. And this Jesus is the one that has been sent into this world to be that particular sacrifice for us. So something to perceive, something provided, something pure, something particular, but there's also something here to proclaim and something that is praiseworthy. This lamb was provided, as the verse goes on, to take away the sins of the world. And this wasn't a lamb, as in the old covenant, maybe perhaps slain for an individual or even for a nation like Israel for their sin, but this was a provision for the whole world. And that includes you, and that includes me. Now that is something to praise God for that we have entered into, but it is also something to proclaim to others that they should enter into also, that Jesus came into this world to bear away our sin. And finally, there's something personal here, and that's to go back to that word behold again. That is a personal call, a call to the individual to look at this lamb as he carries away my sin and your sin. There's something here we're each called to do, to behold the Lamb, and that's what we come now to do, to look at the Saviour as we see him on Calvary bearing our sin. John 1:10 reminds us that he came into the world and the world was made by him, but the world knew him not. He came unto his own and his own received him not, but as many as received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Let's give thanks for the one, this Lamb, as he is described, the Lord Jesus Christ that was sent into this world to bear away your sins and to bear away my sins on that place of Calvary. Our Heavenly Father, we come into your presence and we come before you and we offer you our thanks that you have made that great provision in the Lord Jesus Christ to bear away not only my sins, our Heavenly Father, but for the sins of the world and for all who would call upon your name. And our Father, the words of the hymn come into your mind, my sin, oh the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin, not in part but the whole, is nailed to the cross and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Our Father, we just pray that you will continue with us and bless the remainder of this service for your glory and for your honour alone. Amen. And just at this time then, we will go to another piece of music, and I hope it will be an encouragement to you. When I survey the wondrous cross.
Oh,
Let's read together from the Gospel of John in chapter 1 and the verse 15. I want to look at the character, a little at the character of John the Baptist this morning as we study around his word. So John chapter 1 and verse 15. And it says there, John bare witness of him and cried, saying, "This was he of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have we all received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him." And this is the record of John, when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who art thou?" And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "What then art thou?" "Elias." And he says, "I am not. Art thou that prophet?" And he answered, "No." Then they said unto him, "Who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us? What sayest thou of thyself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah." And they which were sent were of the Pharisees. And they asked him and said unto him, "Why baptizest thou then, if thou be not that Christ, nor Elias, neither that prophet?" And John answered them, saying, "I baptize with water, but there standeth one among you, whom ye know not. He it is who cometh after me, is preferred before me, whose shoe latchet I am not worthy to unloose." Amen. And so reads the word of God. In order to live correctly, there are two very important things that we need to come to a knowledge of. And I believe the Bible teaches us both of them. And the first is that we might come to know God in his triune being. And the second is that we might come to know who we are, to know ourselves, and to understand who we are. It was John Calvin who said that all wisdom we possess is divided into two parts, knowing God and knowing ourselves. And verse 22 of John 1 records that question, "Who are you?" And if someone came to you and asked you that question, or asked me that same question, how would we respond? How would you or I respond to that? Would you describe your job? Would you tell people what you do? Would you tell them your interest, what you like to do in your spare time, or your likes and your dislikes? Well, none of those are really an answer to that question, who are you? They just might describe what you do, what you love to do, what you like to spend your time on, but they don't describe that, answer that question as to who you are. Now, if you went to some great institution somewhere and asked a great scientist who he was, he might respond to you, "Well, I'm just a collection of atoms that has by chance come together into this person that you see standing before you." That might be their response. "Over millions of years, I've evolved from a nutritious soup." They might well say that they believe the fairy tale that we understand as a fairy tale. Every child understands that it is a fairy tale, that one day a frog turned into a prince. And this is what they believe. And this is, you throw millions of years into the equation and they say it's not a fairy tale anymore. It's something that is possible. Well, I believe the only place that we can find the answers to who we truly are and who God truly is lies within this book, the Holy Bible. And it's to here we turn to see what sort of people we should be and ought to be, and what sort of person God is, and how we should relate to him. So what we think about ourselves, what opinion we have of ourselves, what opinion we maybe even have of other people, really, at the end of the day, it's probably not that important, because in all soberness, the only opinion of you or I that really matters is the opinion that God has of us. The only opinion of mankind that really matters is the opinion that God has concerning mankind. And I pray all that listen to my voice would be those who would look within the pages of the Bible, who would see the creation of man, who would see the fall of man, who would understand man's great need of a Savior. There would be those who would look within that book and see who they are in the light of Scripture, that they would be those who would respond to that offer of salvation, who would be forgiven by the grace of God, who would seek to live their lives humbly before God as they journey on their way to their eternal home. But this morning I want to look at this testimony of John the Baptist as he has asked this question, who are you? Now Matthew, let's look at the man, John the Baptist, the man. And Matthew 11:11 reminds us that among those that are born of a woman, there was none that were greater than John the Baptist. Now that's quite a testimony because it's the testimony of Scripture. And I believe, therefore, that he is a man that we can learn much about. And John was a man who was born in a special way, special intervention. John's father, Zechariah, and his mother, Elizabeth, were old, they were increased in years, and they had no children. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto them and said unto Zacharias that he was going to have a child. And this is the child then that became John the Baptist, the one who came before the Lord Jesus Christ. So he was a man who had a miraculous birth. We didn't read this part in our reading this morning, but John 1:6 says that, referring to John, says, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. And the same came for a witness to bear witness of the light. Now the light that it's talking about there is the light of the world, the Lord Jesus Christ. And it says, the same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men, the purpose of bearing witness, that all men might through him believe. As we've just read this man, John, here in these verses, he was a man with a mission. He was a man on a mission as well. And he was a man, very importantly, sent by God. He had all the authority of God behind him, not doing his own thing, but doing God's thing. He was the one who bore witness about the Lord Jesus Christ, not only with his lips, but also with his life and how he lived. He called people to repentance. He called them to that baptism of repentance, as it's referred to within the Bible. And many people listened to this man and responded to his message. And the response to John's ministry was remarkable. People came to John in vast numbers. It says in Matthew 3, verse 5, that Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region all about were going to Jordan. They were going out to him, to John. And people were coming to him. And they were confessing their sins. They realized and recognized that if they were going to be prepared to meet God, they had preparation to make. They had to do something to be prepared to meet God. And that's wise advice that we could give still, to say that we ought to be prepared to meet our God. Even every man and woman, boy and girl born into this world, will one day meet God. And it is something that we must make our soul's preparation to meet with God and be prepared to be there. And this was the message of John. He was preparing people to meet God. But John attracted the attention, his ministry attracted the attention of the local authorities, the religious authorities. And we read in verse 19 that there were others sent to him, priests and Levites. And it's, I suppose, a certain irony here. This is a man who has been sent by God, and here he is. He's going to be questioned by another delegation sent, not from God, but from other men who want to find out about this character, John. And we as Christians, we are sent ones as well. We are all sent ones. And as well, like John, we are no less sent than by the person of the Lord Jesus. We mightn't be commissioned missionaries in the sense that we are formally commissioned to go to another country, financially supported to do so, but we are all commissioned missionaries, all Christians are, and we have that same ministry as John had here, to bear witness of the light, that all men might come to know him and through that might believe. So that's John the man, and then his message. Now, John was a man who preached with great boldness to proclaim the message that he had to proclaim. We read in Matthew 14 the story of how that he confronted Herod in that unlawful marriage that he had to Herodias, his brother's wife. And that was a confrontation that eventually led to his murder. And his message of repentance wouldn't always have been that would have been seen as a palatable message, a savoury message, especially when it was linked to the baptism of repentance, because that was a baptism that was reserved for Gentiles who wanted to become Jews. So in doing that baptism of John, you were almost identifying yourself as a heathen Gentile when you were in fact a Jew by birth. So it would have been something that would have been very humbling for Jews to undergo. So John's message was a bold one that he brought to these people. And John was one who was willing to confront sin. We saw that when he confronted Herod about his unlawful marriage. He was a person who, in his ministry and in his message, he feared God rather than man. He was willing to say unpopular things at times for the glory of God. John chapter 5, a little later in the book that we are in this morning, in verse 35, describes John as a burning and a shining lamp. That's a lovely testimony. John was one who was a shining lamp. He spoke with great insight and great clarity, bringing light into any circumstance, great perception, but he was also a burning lamp. He was one who was impassioned and powerful in what he had to say to these people, and this message of repentance, preparing people to meet God. He spoke, as we would say, with great boldness, with great liberty to men. But then as we go on to look at here, which is what I really want to concentrate on, he spoke with great liberty to men, but he also spoke, he also was very humble towards his God. He was modest and humble before God. So John's message, and then to look at the modesty of John, or his humility. When we read the description of John the Baptist, we see him described as one who wore a garment of camel hair, a leather belt around his waist, and the food that he ate was locusts and wild honey. He was no ordinary person. He, in terms of his appearance and his lifestyle, he was somebody who would perhaps have stood out a little. And it appears that he probably dwelt in the wilderness as well, because he describes himself in the passage that we had read there, the voice crying out in the wilderness. It was hardly an ideal spot, you might say, for setting up a ministry out in the wilderness, not a very accessible location, not a very central place. Perhaps in human terms, we would have said it wasn't a great choice, but this was God's choice. And this man was where God had placed him, and he was carrying out the ministry that God had given to him. We see John as a man who lived modestly and humbly before God. And it's one of the great marks that marks this man, and it's the one that I'm seeking to highlight this morning. And it's a mark that should mark all Christian people. John here preaches in a way that humbles the sinner, but yet exalts the Saviour. And the gospel is always that message that humbles the sinner, points out their sin, it points out the fact that they need a Saviour. It humbles them, but then it points them to Christ and tells them this is the person that you need to flee to find the answer and the cure for your sin problem. It humbles the sinner and exalts the Saviour. And so it ought to mark, that humility ought to mark the lives of those who are Christian people whose lives are being moulded and changed by that living gospel, that they are those who should make little of themselves and be those who make much of the Lord Jesus. Now, the Jews had sent these priests and Levites from Jerusalem, and they asked that question that we looked at the start there. Who are you? Verse 19. And John had gained a little notoriety, and there was some interest piqued about this man. This delegation had come to John, and they says, we want to know who you are. Tell us all about yourself. What makes you tick, John? And this, we live in a world even today that's fascinated by people. And that's why there's so many celebrity magazines that we find in the shelves of bookshops, you know, who we want to know the inside story in their private lives. We want to know what's going on, what makes them tick, what clothes they're wearing, who they're dating, all the things that they've said, maybe This is the sort of thing that interests people in the world today. We like to know about people, about sportsmen and women, about celebrities, wealthy people, politicians, whatever people are interested in. They want to know about their private lives even and what goes on there. And this is a delegation coming to John. They've heard of this man and they want to know a little about him. They want to find out who he is and what he's about. So this delegation comes to John and they say to him, "We want to know more about you, John." And this is the character of John. If you read through the passage again, read through it later. And this is the character of John. They come to him and say, "We want to know about you, John." And John says, "I'm here to point you to Christ. This is not about me. This is about the Lord Jesus." In verse 1 and chapter 1, verse 20, it says that he confessed, and he did not deny, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." So there was perhaps in the mind of these Pharisees at least the possibility they thought that this man John might have been the Christ. They were expecting the Messiah that was expected to come. He spoke with a great power in the Holy Spirit. He had a remarkable following of people who followed after him. Lives were being changed through his ministry. People were repenting of their sins. They perhaps thought that maybe he was the Christ, but John gives the emphatic answer that "I am not the Christ. I'm not the Savior. I'm not the answer to people's greatest need." That lies within someone else. When you serve others, when you love others and serve them, you sometimes feel that you are the one who can fix their problems and must fix their problems. But John's word reminds us here that we are not the Savior. We're not the Savior of our neighbour or our friend or our work colleague, of our husband or our wife or our children. This is a role that we can't fulfil. It's a burden that we cannot bear ourselves. Our role, we may be burdened for their soul, but we cannot bear that burden that they need taken away. That can only be fulfilled as we point them to the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the only one that can answer those needs and the greatest needs of men and women's souls. We are not the Christ. We can only simply and humbly point them to the one that they need to deal with. And then they asked him in verse 21, and they asked him then, "What then, are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." Now this was Elijah who performed many signs and great wonders by the power of God. He prayed that it would stop raining, and it stopped raining for 3.5 years. And he raised the son of the widow to life, and he prayed for fire to fall from heaven and to consume the sacrifice on Mount Carmel before the prophets of Baal. So Elijah was a great wonder worker, a great miracle worker. And they come to him and they say, "Well, are you this person that is to come, this great Elijah?" And John says, "I'm not." John here perhaps was still in the Old Covenant because Jesus hadn't died while in the New Testament. But John here is perhaps the greatest of the Old Covenant prophets. And he did no miracles at all. He doesn't claim to be a miracle worker. His role and his function and his ministry alone was simply to prepare people to meet God, to point them to the Lord Jesus. And then they say to him, "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." It's an interesting way that it's phrased there. Are you that prophet? Are you the prophet? The question is there. And it's a reference to a passage in the Old Testament where there was a prophet foretold that would come in the last days. And it says there in Deuteronomy 18:15, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you." Now the delegation here that has come to question John here wants to know, are you that prophet? Are you this prophet that Moses, like the one like Moses, this prophet like Moses who can commune directly with God, who can bring revelation directly from God like Moses did in Mount Sinai with the law directly revealed to him and brought to the people? And John says, "No, I'm not that prophet, but I am one who is here to point you to the Lord Jesus." So when we think about those questions that John was asked, we recognize that what we say about ourselves is very important. What perception we put of ourselves towards other people is very important. And John knew who he was, but even more importantly, he knew who Christ was. And he had a real opportunity here, John, in this question to push the boat out maybe and make a wee bit of a name for himself. But he doesn't do that. He's a humble and modest and honest man before these people. But John then goes on and he does reveal his true heart and his true modesty and his true agenda and mission to this delegation. He says, you've come out all the way here to find out about me, to find out what makes me tick and what's going on. But let me now take you and point you to another person. Let me point you to the Lord Jesus Christ. And then in John 1, 26, we read, it says, among you stands one you don't even know, one who comes after me, preferred before me, the strap of whose sandal John didn't feel worthy even to unloose. John says, you're coming out here to find out about me, to know who I am, but I'm all about telling you about the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm not worthy to untie his sandals. I'm here to point you to someone else, someone that you don't even know yet. They hadn't seen Jesus yet, and John is here pointing them and preparing the way for them to meet Jesus. But you think about the man who said this. This was John the Baptist. This was, as we read, the greatest man born of a woman, one who had a miraculous birth, filled with the Holy Spirit from birth, a man sent from God, on a mission from God, a very successful ministry going on, and he touched many people's lives. One of the greatest people that ever lived, but yet he says, I'm not unworthy to untie the sandals on Jesus' feet. That's a great humility that he expresses, and a great recognition that we should, as Christian people, all recognize the position that we stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, the great Saviour of this world, and we are those who stand before him, bow before him, and we say that we are not even worthy to untie his sandals. It's a message that's very necessary in the world we live in, full of idols, idol worship, celebrities, selfishness, self-centeredness, and it's a word that we desperately need to hear in the world that we live in. According to John, when he's talking about Christians, according to John, a man filled with the Holy Spirit, now remember, this is a man who is full of the Holy Spirit, and according to John, to be filled with the Holy Spirit and what he says here is never something that will elevate yourself, but it is always something that will elevate the Lord Jesus Christ. If you meet somebody that's full of an ego, you can be pretty sure that they're not full of the Spirit at the same time. It might be, no matter what they claim about themselves, because the Holy Spirit is that which will always exalt Christ and not the man or the woman. Other people might come around and seek to make something of that man or woman and lift them up, but you will always find that person standing pointing to the Lord Jesus. They will be not taking the glory that is due the Lord Jesus. They will be pointing to the Lord Jesus. Great humility. When John says, I'm not worthy, in John 1, 27, he's making an important statement, not only there about himself, but also about the Lord Jesus. He's a man filled with the Holy Spirit, and a man filled with the Holy Spirit will always say he's not worthy. And this reminds us that at our Christian best, no matter what progress that we make within the Christian life, we are simply those who are sinners saved by the mercy of God. Our hope rests not in ourselves, not in any progress that we make, but our hope rests on the mercy of God through Jesus Christ. John recognized here that unless the Lord build the house, those that build it labour in vain. So the character of John here calls us to examine ourselves, not that we might congratulate ourselves, not that we might be those who glory in ourselves, but that we might be able to, with John, say that I know myself. I know who I am. I know who I am in the light of who God is. And he says that he, in that knowledge, knowing what kind of man he is, knowing what kind of person the Lord is, and in that knowledge he says, I'm not worthy to unloose his sandals. He says elsewhere that he must increase and I must decrease. And the antidote to self lies in knowing Jesus and in knowing ourselves, truly knowing Jesus and truly knowing ourselves through the words and the message of this book that is before us, the Holy Bible. So when you see the glory of God, the Son of God, that he would want to be your friend, that he would stoop so low, that he would wash your feet, that he would lay down his life for you, that he would bring you into the family of God, if you would take your stand then in the light of that, knowing that, if you take your stand with John today and see yourselves as we ought, we will grow in humility. That is the one thing that Christian people, men and women, should be growing in, is growing in humility. We should grow in humility. We should be drawn to worship the one who has done all for us. And we should be there to offer our service and our love to the one who loved us first and who gave himself for us. And the one who we would agree with John, when we see ourselves in the light of our Saviour, that we are not worthy even to untie his sandals. So John truly was a great man, great in humility, a remarkable man, a man who understood himself, and more importantly, understood himself in the light of who the Lord Jesus Christ was. And may we be men, I encourage us, may we be men and women who have that right perspective of ourselves and know who God is. Get into this book and know who God is and know and understand who we are and our position before that God. I pray that these thoughts will be a blessing to us. And just let's close our time together around the word with a prayer, just using the words of a hymn that I thought was quite appropriate and better than that I could have phrased myself. So let's just close together in a word of prayer. O Jesus Christ, grow thou in me, and all things else recede. My heart be daily nearer thee, from sin be daily freed. Make this poor self grow less and less, be thou my life and aim. O make me daily through thy grace more worthy of thy name. Let faith in thee and in thy might my every motive move. Be thou alone my soul's delight, my passion and my love. Amen.